Now being asked to do anything that none of us hasn't done before in our own kitchens in our own home. Now quick, Niles, kill five eels.
The Wrestling Life.
Hey everybody, it's The Wrestling Life. It's episode 290. It is Royal Rumble weekend 2022. How long have we been doing this show? I'm Ethan.
I'm Liam.
Liam, we have so much to talk about this week.
And as always, so many things we can't talk about, especially Big John Studd, here on the first and the only wrestling podcast.
Nor his son, Big Sean Studd, who works the local indie here.
I did not know that.
Yeah, he didn't start. We're not even 60 seconds in and we're doing the thing that I just said we weren't going to do. His son didn't start wrestling till like he was in his earlier mid 30s or something, but I think he still works the local indie here. Yeah.
Well, good for him.
Yeah.
Anywho,
it's the Royal Rumble preview show. Let's touch on some not Royal Rumble stuff, news and wrestling before we get to the main event here, which is the Royal Rumble. Mustafa Ali, WWE, is up to their old tricks, refusing to release the guy who went public and demanded his release. That's interesting.
Yeah, especially because we have this earnings call coming up and people always get axed after it anyway.
Yes.
So that will be curious, because if it's just like a weird thing and they want to delay it so they can release him in a group, that's kind of weird. But if they release a bunch of people but don't release him, then we know that it's pure spite to not let him out of that contract.
Yeah. Yeah. It's right before. Well, he was going to have a 90 day anyway. Right. Sure. But I was going to say it's right before AEW is running Chicago, but they're back in Chicago next week. They run Chicago pretty often. But anyway, they're back in Chicago next week. His hometown where he was a police officer, et cetera, et cetera. I feel like there's a few different tacks you can take when requesting your release. He picked one that didn't work rather than just say flying himself home in the middle of a house show loop. It has made me wonder whether or not Tony Storm actually did get a release, because WWE released like through a back channel statement of like she's no longer with the company, but we never got the "we wish her the best in her future endeavors" thing. It makes me wonder, and I don't know who she's talked to, but it's like I wonder if she actually did get a release.
That is, like you said, the wording is very specific, it seemed, when we talked about that. It was not a WWE has released. Obviously, they don't really announce releases anymore, but
yes.
Even when I think it was Sean Ross Sapp initially reported it, it was like the way it was worded. He worded it was very not like he usually words things.
Right.
So, yeah, didn't seem like that was a typical release 90 day and we're done type deal. So that does bring that into question. Then yeah, you wonder, as the story goes, Ali has just been a healthy scratch for a couple of months now. I guess the word originally, the not really looked into word, was he was on paternity leave, which was apparently for one show.
Yes.
And then they just have had nothing for him to do. Not even bringing him to do. I guess SmackDown doesn't have like a Superstars or main event taping beforehand. So he doesn't need, they're not even bringing him to, you know, be a bump dummy for Veer or whoever.
Right. Yeah, definitely. Definitely interesting. Yeah. So he's been off, you know, and then the story that you can only imagine, a heated argument with Vince McMahon regarding a pitch that McMahon made to Ali. Do you think they wanted him to wear a turban and be an evil foreigner?
In Vince McMahon's company? Oh, I don't perish the thought. Yeah, no, I think that's probably what happened. I think the guy that maybe pitched a and aired a vignette for a Japanese character called Hirohito in like 2005 might have asked the Muslim man to put on a turban and play a terrorist. Yes.
The guy who, the brainchild behind the mastermind whose brainchild was Kung Fu Naki.
Yes. Yes. I think it is possible that that guy may have asked Mustafa Ali, who has a, there's a wonderful like WWE producer. I think it's, I don't know if it's Chronicle or 24 or whatever. They have like three or four different names for their network documentaries, but they did one on him a few years ago.
Yeah.
And there's like a specific part in this WWE produced documentary where he talks about how when he was first breaking into wrestling, he did that character very briefly. And he had a very horrific moment where he saw the reaction that a child had to him in the stands. And he was horrified by it because he felt like maybe he just taught a kid to hate people that look like him.
Right.
And so from that moment forward, he vowed that he would never, ever do that, even though he knew at the time on the indies, he would make more money doing that.
Right.
He, for his own personal reasons, chose not to do that. And so, yeah, it's like, it's part of his story, even within, even since he's been in WWE, he has told that story repeatedly of, you know, wanting to avoid stereotypes and wanting to be, you know, a kind of a very unique, has a unique message that he wants to send. And yeah, I'm going to guess that Vince McMahon said, yeah, but what if we put you in a turban and gave you a sword?
I think it's worth noting too that it's not like he's against playing a heel. Like, he released a vignette that they had produced for him that ultimately never aired on TV, but he released it on his social media where he was playing like a politician who only in Vince McMahon's WWE could like a populist politician be a heel, but it seemed like very much like a heel vignette. And at one point it was approved and then it wasn't. So I don't, you know, it's not like the guy's against being a heel. He just doesn't want to be a certain kind of heel.
Correct. So yeah, I guess we'll come back to this one after this earnings report and the seemingly inevitable next series of releases and see what's what then.
Yeah. It seems like maybe they're getting NXT UK primed for a cut. I think maybe Nick Khan has become aware.
He finally found out about Hunter's secret little.
Yeah, it's a thing that exists.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so they brought Kaylee Ray over, and I mean, it's been a couple months now that they brought her over, but
Walter, yeah. Gunther is here now.
Yeah. Is that anything? Like, we have done a show since WWE renamed Walter Gunther. And I don't put anything past that company, but I have a difficult time believing that they would want anything to do, they would purposely name a guy after a Nazi. I don't think they did that on purpose.
I think in 2003 they would have, but I think, yeah, in this era of the more brand safe. I know I just said that, I just brought up the hero, you know, thing like a minute ago, but we just been talking about how he was potentially asking a Muslim man to play a certain type of stereotype. But that specifically is a line that I think most people, there's less deniability when it comes to Nazi stuff, I think. So I don't know, like, it's not this person that he happened to share the attempted copyrighted name of, is not like a particularly famous person. It was just, that was the first Google result until it suddenly was flooded with a bunch of news articles about WWE trying to copyright this name. But so at that point, I think, yeah, they just went, well, I guess we really want his name to be Gunther. Like,
right.
So, I mean, it is strange. It's not the first time, I guess, Eric and Ivar got name changes despite being named their other names on NXT television for years. So I guess that's where Prime, and I don't think Walter moved to the States to wrestle in just regular NXT. Maybe he did, but I would assume maybe he's not going to be in regular NXT too long before he comes up. And I guess they didn't like Walter. They didn't sound German enough, even though he's not German.
There's a lot of layers to it. There are a lot of layers to it. Also, the one time Vince McMahon saw the guy, he jobbed him out in like 90 seconds.
That's true. Like, he was unpinned for like 2 years on NXT television and then was pinned in 90 seconds in a Survivor Series match or whatever it was.
Yeah. So it's like, do you think, and this is Vince 3 years ago or 4 years ago or whatever. It's like, do you think he's changed his mind since then? I doubt it, but I guess we'll see.
I don't know. Like Walter Gunther has dropped some weight as of late. So I don't know if that was part of the, if he was told to like get in better shape, and we'll take another look at you or whatever, or, you know, a lot of guys might get called up and still be gone within 2 months. So it's not like getting primed for he'll just get like the main event match, like Ciampa and Dunn are getting right now. And whoever else in LA Knight are getting, and then we'll never hear from him again. These are all equally possible to me.
Yeah, I want to. Yeah, let's get into those guys here real quick before we talk about AEW, and then we'll talk about Royal Rumble. But LA Knight to me is getting a look, and to me, his promos are like super, super low rent Dwayne Johnson. Mm-hmm. But I feel like maybe he's gonna stick at least for a while, because he does talk better than most WWE main roster people talk. Do you see him having any kind of legs? Obviously, they've sent Ciampa back to NXT, so I don't think he's going to stick on with his chocolate beard. I don't think he's going to stick on the main roster. We'll see about Pete Dunne. That seems unlikely to me also. A 5'6" guy in Vince McMahon's, who can work in Vince McMahon's WWE, who wrestles in a one-piece bathing suit, I don't see working. But maybe LA Knight can stick because he can talk a little bit. What do you think?
I feel like the biggest thing Knight has against him is his age, right? He's 38 or 39. So, I mean, but if they're giving him a look despite his age, then yeah, maybe he does have a chance to at least. I mean, who would have thought Bobby Roode would have like a 7-year WWE career, right? Like, mm-hmm. And he's around that age too. He's probably older though. He's probably like 44 now.
Yeah, Bobby is Bobby's significantly older.
So like, who would have thought he would make it through like like 115 people get cut and Rob Roode is not one of them in Vince McMahon's WWE. So I think if you need guys like a guy like an LA Knight, not that I think he's like a spectacular worker, but he's been around a long time, and as you said, he can talk, he can do a 10-minute or 15-minute talking segment in the middle of a show, or probably do comedy with R-Truth I think he's like what you would call a utility player that could probably find a role on a Raw, a 3-hour Raw or a SmackDown.
Yeah. So what's left for the guys that got the look and didn't make it? Like, I assume Roderick Strong, Ciampa, Pete Dunne, are they in the next round of cuts?
I could see it. I mean, I think both Dunne and Roddy re-signed last year, like just prior to the apocalypse,
the purge. Yeah.
I it seems like that. I mean, we've heard this story a lot. Obviously, O'Reilly and Gargano being the two most recent one of, they went up, got a look. Adam Cole came up to SmackDown. I don't know if Adam Cole did a dark match or not, but. Like a lot of these guys coming up doing a dark match or something, or I guess in some of these guys' cases, they're doing matches on main event with Dijak and it's like,
Lonnie Donegan.
Yeah, old Lonnie Donegan. I never remembered if he was T-Bar or Slapjack, so I just call him Donovan Dijak.
He was T-Bar. He was T-Bar.
Okay. Yeah. I assume he still is, right? They didn't turn him back to...
Correct. Yes.
All right. So T-Bar is wrestling all those different NXT guys. I don't know. All of them could find a place, but probably not in this current Sure, like there's all of these guys could be an asset to your television, but if your thing is that you're small and you're a very good wrestler, they've sort of gutted that diamond slowly gutted that diamond mine group that Roddy is in NXT. Like they just fire a different guy from it every few weeks. So if Roddy goes, and he was kind of the centerpiece of it, I guess they can move more 2.0 talent into it, or give Bivens somebody else to, or give Bivens a new group to work with. But
he's got the Creed brothers now in that group, and that's like right. clearly the focus of that group. They're in the Dusty Cup, and I don't know if they're going to win the thing. I think MSK might win the thing again, but they're gonna be there. That show every week is totally missable, but it's not a bad show. Of the WWE main roster shows or the WWE television shows, I would say it's way better than Raw. It's usually not as good as SmackDown because there's not the star power you have of Roman Reigns and stuff, but it's a totally fine show.
Yeah, I admittedly don't watch the full shows many weeks of NXT, but I always get like, yeah, this is a WWE, Vince McMahon, Bruce Pritchard, like this is the 2022 equivalent of, superstars or wrestling, it's right. obviously it's longer and there's more like skits and stuff, but that's the kind of vibe I get when I watch it. It doesn't offend me when I turn it on, but yeah, it seems like at this point, that's the thing too. It's like if they fire all, or if they release a bunch of more of these guys, if Roddy and Dunn and Ciampa are maybe on their way out, then like who's left that's going to actually like teach like Grayson Waller or whoever to, is that the forehead guy? Whoever the forehead guy is that they're high on.
It's not Ridge Holland. I can't think of that guy's name.
Anyway,
Grayson Waller. Guys. Grayson Waller is the skinny Australian guy.
That's right.
Keep talking. I'll think of it.
But it's like who's left to like actually like pull these guys through televised matches every week if they get rid of I understand like you don't see value in Dunn as like a star on your television show, but don't you still need to keep like two or three of these guys just to like teach everybody how to work?
Yeah, you would think, and you would think that that's the point of the whole point of having those guys around. But Cameron Grimes is another guy too that it's like I think he's goofy comedy guy if he goes to the main roster, but but also R-Truth just turned 50 and he still has a job, so
I'll say, I mean, there's worse gigs to get than guy who makes Vince McMahon laugh professionally.
Yes. Von Wagner is the forehead guy, by the
way. There we go. Couldn't think of it. Okay. Jeez. Lonnie Donegan.
That's right. All right, before we get to Royal Rumble, let's get into AEW. So Hangman Page is the world champion, and he's been on television like twice since he won the title. 2.5 months ago, probably because he has an infant and COVID petri dishes are bad places to hang out if you have an infant at home. And so that's very understandable, but just a lot of weird dynamites in a row to me. And admittedly, I'm not the biggest fan of All Elite Wrestling. I'll just say if I had arguably the most talented roster ever assembled, I don't know that I would have put on a string of television shows like they've put on with like Billy Gunn wrestling on TV and Red Velvet versus Layla Hirsch and just a lot of the matches that they do every week. Not things that I would do if I had their roster, but hey, so they did Beach Break this week. They're building obviously to Hangman Page and Lance Archer in a Texas death match for the AEW title in a couple of weeks. That's like the placeholder before the pay-per-view world title feud. There's Britt Baker doesn't really have a challenger right now. I assume
that was evident when they just had her come out to just say mean things about the city of Cleveland for 8 minutes on Dynamite last week.
That was frankly bizarre. Yes. CM Punk and MJF wrestling next week in Chicago. They might be able to stretch that to the pay-per-view the next month. We'll see how that goes, but a lot of to use MJF's word, a lot of mid dynamites to me so far this year. What are your thoughts just overall on the state of All Elite Wrestling?
It feels like, I think you kind of hit the nail on the head at the start, with as much talent is on this roster, I understand there's certain matches that you're saving for pay-per-view or that you want to build to over a long period of time, and that's fine, and that's good.
Right.
And I know that, like, you know, Danielson was off TV for a while. He's back, seems to be starting up something with Moxley, who is also back now. You'll have Kenny back hopefully in a few months. So that's another, you know, another bow in your quiver. But it feels stagnant. Like CM Punk and MJF started feuding in December, which I guess it's not really that long ago, but it feels really long ago to me.
Yes.
It's probably been like 6 weeks, but it feels like they've been going at it for a while. And then you have like MJF and Adam Cole and the Elite versus Best Friends has been going on for 1,000 years. And I enjoyed the Lights Out match. I thought it was a good way. It's a way to give Orange Cassidy, who has been beaten like a drum for 3 months, a win in a match with Adam Cole without having it hurt Adam Cole theoretically. But it just feels very creatively stagnant to me. And then I feel like, with the exception of at the start of the year, you had at the end of last year and the start of this year, you had the two Danielson Hangman matches, which were both great. And then on this week's show, you did have the ladder match, which I thought was very good. But it's a lot of like stuff that I thought was just okay. And I think when you don't have a lot of great wrestling on your shows, it becomes, the flaws of your show become a lot more apparent. The cut and paste nature of the angles they run, how long people have been in feuds against each other, Chris Jericho's FUNB Hulk Hogan WCW 2000 character sucks.
Yeah, it's
and like the stuff that's getting a lot of television time on Dynamite. Meanwhile, as you said, like Britt Baker doesn't have a challenger, Hangman is wrestling Kane, and you have like a bunch of people that you feel like should be a bigger deal on Dynamite. The Bucks are kind of like they kind of started a few weeks ago, and O'Reilly wasn't on Dynamite, I think, the last 2 weeks. I don't know if he's a COVID guy or what was up with that, but Rocky got pulled from a show for COVID, and then O'Reilly wasn't on Dynamite last night. So they were kind of teasing doing a Bucks and Red Dragon thing, but then that's also wrapped up in this never ending Elite versus Best Friends thing, which I hope is over now. I guess I'm just ready to see like fresher storylines and more, with the amount of good professional wrestlers they have on their roster. I feel like we should be getting one to two just like great kick-ass matches every week. And I feel like there's been strings of Dynamites where we've gotten that in the past. But when we have a string of Dynamites all in a row where there's very little or no good to great wrestling on it, kind of starts to feel a little bit more like a drag. But, you know, we'll see. Like we said, it seems like the next 2 weeks are going to be maybe reset shows. And I would assume, based on the finish of MJF and Punk, we'll either find out that they're rematching at the pay-per-view, or if it is a clean finish, then I'm guessing the winner of that is wrestling Hangman at the pay-per-view. So maybe now that we're like, that's the other thing too, we've talked about this before, they always wait until like 3 weeks out from their pay-per-views to start actually building towards them, I feel.
Yes.
So that's the other thing too. I think there's just like an aimless feel. It's like, okay, Sammy just beat Cody in a ladder match on television. It's like, okay, so what's he doing? We're like a month out to this pay-per-view now, or a little over a month out. Britt doesn't have any clear challengers, and Adam Page, like I said, he's kind of waiting around to see. You can slide a few different people in there. You could do MJF, you could do Punk, you could do Adam Cole, but until we kind of get moving, we have to wait 2 more weeks for him to get done beating Lance Archer before we could even get to that. So it just feels like we're just in a real like holding pattern with Dynamite. And like I said, the kind of the more stagnant things get, the more you start to notice the flaws in the machine, I think.
Adam Cole, I'm a big fan. He is the focus of the television. He wrestles on Rampage most weeks. He wrestles on Dynamite most weeks. He gets a promo segment on Dynamite most weeks. Adam Cole's very clearly going to be going for the world title here sooner than later, because he has to be, because he's the focus of every television show.
Everybody wants to kiss him. Who can blame them? I guess the other note from Dynamite is Danhausen got signed. So good for him making some money.
Yeah. I don't care.
That's one of those guys, like, I felt so out to lunch because there was like legitimate discourse about Danhausen on Twitter.
Yes.
Last night and today. And I was like, he's just like, he's a comedy guy. Like, if it's not your thing, I don't think you're wrong for not liking it, but it's like, he's not going to be, I mean, maybe it's weird to say this in a company that Orange Cassidy is like an upper card baby face in, but like, I think like, I'm not worried about like Danhausen wrestling Kenny Omega or like CM Punk or somebody. Like, he's going to be a fun character. Like, it's a variety show, right? A wonderful variety show. And you want some comedy guys on there. He's going to do shtick with Billy Gunn and his dickhead sons. And he's going to do, and he'll do goofy stuff on Dark and on Being the Elite. And he'll be around, and he'll pop up as cameos like he did in the middle of matches and stuff like that. And the crowd will go crazy for him, and he'll sell a bunch of t-shirts. But I just had, when I saw like people legitimately arguing over this, I was like who cares enough about this to really have like a strong opinion one way or the other? Like, God bless him. And it's, you know, he's a guy like that who went from like a low level indie guy to a guy that was getting booked everywhere to Ring of Honor to now the second biggest company in the US. It's like, that's impressive. Like, he just kind of built that brand himself. So like, good for him. Good for him.
Before we get to Royal Rumble, GCW ran pay-per-view this past weekend.
Oh yeah.
One of the worst shows I've ever seen. It was really terrible. A really terrible show with maybe one or two good matches on it.
Yeah, it was like, okay, and admittedly, I'm not a GCW expert here, but I've watched like three or four of their shows. This was easily the worst GCW show I've ever seen. Like, I didn't think it was paced well. I thought a lot of it dragged. I was also watching the greatest football game of all time on my friend's phone while we kind of had the show on in the background for part of it. So I didn't maybe experience like the Cardona Janela marathon in as much excruciating detail as other people
sure
did. So maybe I just thought a lot of it was boring. I thought the decision to beat all of, like almost all of their like homegrown GCW stars, like it felt like this should have been like a big celebration show where you do a lot of happy moments for your longtime fans and you're introducing. And obviously they expected new fans to come in. So I guess the idea is, well, this isn't really the big show. This is our first step towards an even bigger show. But I just, yeah, it wasn't very good. It was a bad ladder match on the show. There was a really great Lucha match and then a bunch of okay stuff. And then Nick Gage's return was the main event, but they were in New York, so they couldn't really do any Nick Gage stuff. And then they got 5 minutes. So... And then it was right off the air. So, yeah, bad show. And look, hopefully they learned some lessons. And the next time they get a big show, it'll be even better. But, I mean, it's low bar.
Yeah. They run basically two big shows every weekend. I mean, they're not sold out in front of 2,000 people. And on traditional pay-per-view, they're, you know, 500-seat shows. And on Fight TV every weekend, but they run so many shows, and I don't know. I would not be surprised if that was the apex of the promotion. Let's put it that way. I don't think they're going to go out of business anytime soon. I wish them the best. There's things that they did on that show that I appreciate and respect, like main eventing with Nick Gage. It's like Nick Gage is not my guy, but he's their guy. And yes. I respect that. I respect that they were like, okay, we're going to headline with one of our guys. I respect that. The tribute to the people that have passed away on the pre-show. It's like, okay, that's very nice and kind. And I respect that. It was not a good show. And the Janela and Cardona match, like, it was overbooked to the point of parody, and that was the idea. And the people were into it.
Mm-hmm.
People were into all the run-ins and cameos, let's put it that way. But also, after they saw 56 run-ins and cameos in that match, it killed the crowd for the rest of the show. It's like, if you're going to do that, that had to be like last because it right. killed the next hour and a half of the show.
I also wonder like how many fans that went there were like aware that like they couldn't do barbed wire and glass and light tubes and stuff, because the two top matches on the show were Moxley versus Homicide. And then, as you mentioned, Nick Gage and
Matt Tremont
against the Briscoes.
Right.
And again, Nick Gage being the king of the death match, Moxley being, you know, a hardcore legend and all this stuff. It's like I think maybe they were expecting more violence, and it was just like some chairs and some like flimsy doors and stuff like that. And again, that's the restrictions of the show, but it was one of those things where it's like, the decision to do this show in Hammerstein is what got you this attention and got you probably without a doubt their biggest pay-per-view numbers of all time. But also they couldn't do a bunch of the stuff that like GCW is known for. And again, they're not right. only a deathmatch promotion, but when you have Nick Gage and John Moxley and these guys on the show, you expect a lot more, I think, blood and guts, if you will.
Sure.
Gory self-mutilation, if you will, on a show like that with those guys on it. And so I thought that was like, felt like fans were waiting for the violence to ramp up, and that never really came as well. So I feel like that hurt the crowd as well.
And Moxley and Homicide got like 11 minutes also. Like, mm-hmm. not that I necessarily want to see those two guys go for 25 minutes or whatever, but there were some serious timing issues all over that show. So,
oh yeah.
All right. So Royal Rumble's coming up this weekend. The more interesting side to me, shockingly, is the women's side, just because they absolutely have not even hinted as to who could possibly win the men's Royal Rumble. How is this even possible? Like, normally there's, anyway, my takeaway is that it has to be somebody who is involved in one of the title matches already is going to like mm-hmm. lose and then win the Rumble. So Brock, Roman, Seth, somebody like that is going to win the Royal Rumble through shenanigans. But like, they haven't begun to tease anyone winning the Royal Rumble.
Nope.
All right. So Angelo Dawkins, Montez Ford, Rey Mysterio, Dominic Mysterio, The Great Austin Theory, Sheamus, Johnny Knoxville, Damian Priest, AJ Styles, Big E, Happy Corbin and Madcap Moss, Sami Zayn and Kofi Kingston, Kevin Owens, Omos, Randy Orton, Riddle, Chad Gable, Otis, Dolph Ziggler, Robert Roode. So 22 out of 30 on the men's side have been announced. And one of the less reputable wrestling news sites today reported that Bad Bunny is also in. So that would be 23 spots. Meh.
It doesn't feel like anybody in that group, other than like you said, like we talked about last week, and where you said already on this show, like, yeah, it's probably Bobby Lashley or Brock Lesnar or Roman Reigns, depending on which one of them loses in their respective title matches, right? Like,
yeah.
Like, because who else? Because who else is getting any kind of like big shove on on WWE television right now.
It's, nobody. It's the only wild card to me is Owens, just because I don't think Kevin Owens is going to win the Royal Rumble, but he did just re-sign there, and like, he's one of a few a handful of guys to get serious promo and TV time. It's like Owens, Rollins, Lashley, Lesnar, Reigns, and then Big E has kind of been phased down a little bit, but it's like one of those five. It has to be one of those five guys, because it couldn't be anybody else. So,
and like, Edge isn't in the match as far as we know, right?
Correct. Yeah, he and his wife are wrestling The Miz and his wife.
Sure. So yeah, I just, there's, yeah, it's a very fascinating thing for there just to be like nobody even like hinted at on television that you feel could possibly win this, other than one of the guys who is supposedly not in the match.
Right.
Like, it's interesting.
So on the women's side, they've announced 21 people: Rhea Ripley, Nikki A.S.H., Dana Brooke, Carmella, Queen Zelina, Tamina, Shotzi, Natalya, Aaliyah, Naomi, Shayna Baszler. SmackDown Women's Champion Charlotte Flair is in the match for some reason. The Bella Twins, Lita, Michelle McCool, Kelly, WWE Legend Summer Rae, Impact Knockouts Champion Mickie James, Bianca Belair, and Liv Morgan have been announced. And Ronda Rousey is probably coming back. So to me, the thing that makes the most sense is somebody dumps Charlotte Flair, and whoever dumps Charlotte challenges her for the title at WrestleMania, and the other person wins the Royal Rumble, goes on to challenges Becky. And it sure would make sense if that were Ronda Rousey, but also Ronda Rousey and Charlotte Flair sure seems like a match that they would do rather than Ronda and Becky, but we'll see.
It's the match they wanted to do.
Yep.
That was supposed to be the first ever women's main event of WrestleMania.
Yep.
So that would be funnier, I think. I do want, like, so there was, and again, you never know, because like, who's coming out of what camp at the end, but it was like, the story was like, Ronda was really like offended that fans turned on her.
Right.
Which is very funny to me. But
she's very sensitive. She's very sensitive.
But like, would she, if she is agreeing to come back and wrestle, would she risk coming back as a baby, trying to come back as a baby face and getting booed again?
Maybe. Yeah.
Well, the other thing is, like,
if it doesn't work, you just turn. Like,
right. But again, she seems to take great offense to when the audience members don't go along with the play.
So she comes back as a heel and Becky's a baby face. Like, Becky's, how could you possibly boo Becky Lynch anyway? But except for marrying Seth Rollins, but
yeah. But, kid's gonna suck.
but yeah, like, it's like, people don't want to boo Becky Lynch anyway. So if she's coming back and wrestling Becky, then you make Becky a babyface. Who cares?
Yeah, I guess I would just be curious as to, my heart of hearts hope is that this is another Survivor Series Dwayne situation. Sure. And they're like prepping everything, and they're like, we want you back. We really think it would be cool if you came back at the Rumble and then worked Mania. And she is just going to ghost them. I think that would be really funny. But I think she probably comes back and wins the Rumble and then wrestles either Becky or Charlotte.
Yeah.
If she wrestles Becky, I guess my thought is poor Bianca Belair.
Yeah.
We were told to let it play out. And for the first time ever in WWE history, it doesn't seem like maybe she's going to get her big WrestleMania moment.
It did not play out. No, no. They spent 7 months last year making Bianca Belair, and they spent the 6 months since destroying Bianca Belair.
She is still like, she isn't, she's kind of how they treat, like, I feel like she's a little under like the Bayley Sasha level, Like she's not even quite to that level, but like they gave her the big, they had, well, that's the other funny part. They had her do the big thing where she did gave the KOD to Doudrop like right around Christmas. Right. And it got this enormous reaction. And it was like, that felt like, okay, maybe we're building her back up for something, but then Doudrop just won a three-way to challenge Becky at the Rumble. And at the time you might have, you'd be forgiven for thinking, well, maybe Bianca's going to win the Rumble again. But now that Operation Hot Ronda is back on, like, what are we? I do wonder if there's like a, well, maybe Bianca could dump Charlotte and she could go over to SmackDown and wrestle Charlotte.
Why not? Why not? The thing Bianca has going for her is she's so good and so cool that she's mm-hmm. probably going to end up a big star anyway, just because there's a certain part of her start and that's just absolutely undeniable. She will mm-hmm. not, she will not be denied. It's impossible to keep her down, but damned if they haven't tried over the last 6 months. All right, let's run down the rest of the card here real quick. Brock Lesnar is wrestling Bobby Lashley. He's defending the title against Bobby Lashley. I think Lashley's winning the title here and Roman somehow screws Brock. And Brock ends up chasing Roman for the other title. Any idea on how that one goes?
Yeah, I think that scenario. I mean, I've always felt like this Heyman thing is going to have another shoe drop.
Yeah,
they've done like the fake Heyman is leaving Roman for Brock thing for months and months. And then it had a very abrupt ending to it. And then the next night on Raw, Heyman was just back with Brock. So, I mean, maybe that makes Brock look like a little bit of an idiot. But it's Brock, so whatever. You can't really hurt that guy.
Right. Becky Lynch against Doudrop. I don't think Doudrop is beating Becky Lynch.
Bold statement, but no, I don't think so. Despite the stellar face-to-face promo that they had, just Kevin Dunn's worst nightmare. as two women with thick Celtic accents chatted away on Monday Night Raw.
Look, man, I don't ever want to take Kevin Dunn's side on anything, but I only legitimately understood about 60% of what Nikki A.S.H. and Doudrop said on Raw this week.
That's fair.
Like, they both had significant promo time, and I legitimately had no idea what they were saying. Edge and Beth Phoenix are wrestling The Miz and Maryse. Bucket list thing for Edge and Beth, I think.
Yeah, no, it's cool. I saw an interview with Edge this week where he talked about how he felt like Beth never got a chance to talk when in her like full-time wrestler run. And yeah, he said he felt like her Hall of Fame speech, and then obviously her 3 years now doing commentary or whatever, kind of all of a sudden WWE realized that like she had a personality and could do that part of the job too. So like, yeah, I'm sure it's very, very nice for them. I was trying to think, is there another couple that they can mix tag at Mania? Nikki Bella and Arwen, perhaps.
Sure. Bree and Brian, you can't.
No. What a twist.
Rhonda and Travis.
Yes. There we go. trying to think of what other wrestling couples they could. I guess they could
Walter
do like,
and Jenny.
There you go.
Jenny, whatever her name is.
That's right. Dexter Loomis and Indy Hartwell.
We've come up with we're just naming couples now.
Yeah.
Becky and Seth.
Oh, yeah. I mean, in a world where Becky wasn't probably like in the main event of one of those two nights of the shows, that actually probably is a, like, that would be a big match that I think people would get really into if they did that.
Yeah, I mean, I don't think Becky and Seth want to be on TV together anymore, and frankly, they shouldn't be after the last run, but yeah. Yeah, there's a lot of ways you can go with that, but I also, yeah, I think this is probably it for Edge and Beth as a team, but we'll see. It is strange for doing it at Rumble and not at Mania, though.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's just like, well, what is Edge doing then if he's not...
Right.
He's not going for a title at Mania this year. It's like... I'm trying to do the law of averages thing. He could wrestle Kevin Owens. Like,
yeah,
that
yeah.
seems like a match that both of those guys would want to do.
And well, AJ Styles, I think that.
Oh yes. I did see AJ talking about that this week.
Yeah, that seems like that's coming sooner than later. And Vince still has that thing where he's like, oh, I'm paying Edge $3 million. I have to use him in a big singles match.
There you go. Yep.
Yeah. Roman Reigns and Seth Rollins is the other match for the Universal title. Raw guy Seth Rollins going for the SmackDown title. Whatever.
Usos are banned from ringside.
Yes. So there's a lot of scuttlebutt. There's been a lot of scuttlebutt that, like, Seth Rollins has been supposed to get one of the WWE titles, or it was supposed to get the WWE title at the last pay-per-view, and like he's supposedly been going to end up as champion for a couple of months now. It's just like the way that they book him on TV, I'm like, that guy really? But it's just not the first time I've said with regards to Seth Rollins, that guy really? But anyway, but I guess people are still talking like he's definitely going to have one of the titles going into WrestleMania. I guess we'll see. I don't see anybody beating Roman Reigns unless it's Dwayne Johnson, but I guess we'll find out.
Yeah. I mean, that's the only thing. It's like, well, if Seth wins, then you could do him and Owens, because they've been like really hamming up how they're best friends on television now.
A rare W for WWE creative, a rare bright spot.
They're Kevin so Owens good. and his assorted pals over the last 5 years in WWE, where they're just talking about what great friends they are. Generally great television.
Heels being smarmy about how much they love each other. Always great. That's great stuff. Yeah. All right. We've covered a lot of ground. Is there anything else you want to get into?
No, I think that covers all the big notes of Royal Rumble weekend. What a weekend it should be. And they're doing a big full week of WrestleMania again. So let's look forward to 9,000 WWE shows in 1 week.
Well, in April. So we don't have the NXT show this weekend, you know, because they're not pairing those anymore. But they are doing an NXT show the day of one of the WrestleManias. It's going to be like NXT at noon. And WrestleMania at 7 o'clock or whatever.
You're gonna run it at like Access, like I'm not sure Von Wagner and Lonnie Donegan are gonna fill up a like 10,000 seat arena.
Yeah, I don't think so either. But also another seven hours of wrestling just split over two venues.
Thank you.
Oh yeah, and all right. Well, till next time, everybody. I'm Ethan.
And I'm Liam.
And we'll be back soon with more stories from the wrestling life.
Bye bye.
Thanks for listening. Don't forget to leave us a 5-star review on Apple Podcasts. Now, here are this week's bonus features.
You got any plans for your birthday?
Not really. I'm hanging out with some friends this weekend, but not really on the actual day. Not really doing much. I did take the day off because that's my every year present to myself, is I take my birthday off. So
excellent.
And I'll get to watch WWF's Royal Rumble. So what else? What else could I do on a birthday weekend that would be better than that?
You know, it's difficult to think of much. Okay. Well, the good news is that we should be able to get in and out of here fairly quickly.
Famous last words, but yeah.
Yes. If I don't go off in a tangent about Big John Studd winning the Royal Rumble again. Yeah.
Doesn't make sense.
You know, there were signs 33 years ago that Vince was gone off the deep end. He's like, you know who's going to be my new number two babyface? John Studd.
Hey, Andre can't do anything. Who should we put on house shows with him for the next 6 months? Big John Studd. All right.
Unbelievable.
I try to keep on keeping on.